That's what we got.
Committee will please come back to order. We're pleased now to welcome to our committee hearing Martin Sullivan, who served as the CEO of AIG from March 2005 until June 2008. Before being named CEO, Mr. Sullivan served as Vice Chairman and Co-Chief Operating Officer of AIG. And Robert Willemstad, who served as CEO of AIG from June 2008 until September 2008. Prior to being named CEO, Mr. Willemstad served as chairman of AIG's board of directors beginning in November 2006. He was first elected to AIG's board of directors in January of 2006. We're pleased to welcome both of you to the hearing. It's the practice of this committee that all witnesses who testify before us do so under oath. So I'd like to ask if you would please stand and raise your right hand. Do you solemnly swear that the testimony you'll give before the committee will be the truth, the whole truth, and nothing but the truth? Thank you. The record will indicate that both the witnesses answered in the affirmative. And before we even begin, I'd like the police officer in charge to take the person who's holding up a sign, and let's get that cleared out of the room right now. That woman who is holding up the sign, who intends to hold up a sign and to make a ruckus, I don't think it's appropriate in a congressional committee. Gentlemen, your prepared statements will be in the record in full. And we want to recognize you for any oral presentation that you wish to make. While we usually give 5 minutes, and I know you're mindful of that, I don't want to limit you in any way to the statement and the amount of time that you have to make your statement. Mr. Sullivan, why don't we begin with you? There's a button on the base of the mic, and be sure it's closed.
Okay, I have it now. Thank
you. That's better.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman, and a very good afternoon. My name is Martin Sullivan. As you said, from March 2005 until June of this year, I was President and Chief Executive Officer of AIG. Though I was no longer with the company as the events of last month unfolded, I am here today to assist the committee in understanding the events that led to the federal rescue of AIG, how the example of AIG fits into the broader financial crisis currently plaguing the world economy, and the registry lessons that we can learn from AIG's experience. People around the world are reeling from the financial tsunami that has ravaged the global economy. While we had all hoped that the very unfortunate collapse of Bear Stearns this past spring would be an isolated incident, instead, the financial storm gained momentum and many of the world's most respected financial institutions crumbled one after another. The federal government took control of Freddie Mae and Freddie Mac. Lehman Brothers and IndyMac declared bankruptcy, and Washington Mutual and Wachovia had to be taken over to avoid a similar fate. Meanwhile, other prominent institutions sought additional capital, merger partners, and redefined their corporate status. Of course, AIG avoided potential bankruptcy only with the help of the government. Now the U.S. government is establishing a $700 billion fund to provide additional relief to threatened financial institutions. I hope that my testimony about these events that occurred during my tenure at AIG can help the committee understand the formation of what is best described as a global financial tsunami. While we are all struggling to understand how this crisis happened in the first place and to find out what might have prevented it, there are no simple answers to these questions. I am not an accountant, nor an economist. I have been an insurance man all my life. However, many factors appear to have been at play, including lending and borrowing practices, illiquid markets, the absence of credit, loss of investor confidence, and even accounting rules which require companies like AIG to take billions of dollars of unrealized mark-to-market losses. When in 2005 the AIG board asked me to step into the role of chief executive officer, the company was straining under the weight of several crises very different from the financial crisis currently threatening our financial institutions. I became CEO of AIG at a time when the company was in the midst of governmental investigations that had cast a cloud of suspicion over the company's future. In the face of that crisis, my responsibility was to stabilize the ship and improve our relationships with our regulators. I think I succeeded. It was against that backdrop that I began my tenure as CEO of the company. I'm very proud to say that in spite of these challenges, AIG emerged as a successful and resilient company. In 2006 and in early 2007, AIG was enjoying great success, and those of us within the company's management had tremendous confidence in our company's future. However, as we now know, a different storm was gathering over the global financial markets. No disaster as massive or as unforeseen and unprecedented financial market disruption that has occurred over the past year is the result of a simple or single cause. The world's current economic challenges are obviously related to multiple actions by multiple parties. To assist the committee, I would like to focus on one particular factor, the role played by one accounting rule applied to corporations. The accounting rules require that certain assets be marked to market. In other words, companies must declare the value of those assets on a quarterly basis at the price such assets could sell for on the market at that point in time. Companies must declare these values on their books, even if they have no intention of or immediate need to sell the assets, or even if they have not realized any actual gain or actual loss. FAS 157, which was adopted relatively recently, set out specific guidelines on how companies must determine the market price of certain categories of assets. However well FAS 157 operates under any reasonably foreseeable market conditions, in the unprecedented credit crisis which began in the summer of 2007, FAS 157 had, in my opinion, unintended consequences. In a distressed market where assets cannot be readily sold, companies are forced to declare the value of those assets at fire sale prices. Just last week, the SEC made changes with respect to the application of FAS 157 when entire markets stopped functioning. Of course, AIG did not have the benefit of this guidance during my tenure. At AIG, I encountered FAS 157's unintended effects through the credit default swap portfolio of AIG Financial Products, a business that my predecessor had established and funded many years earlier. These credit default swaps essentially provided insurance to counterparties in the case of default on underlying bonds. The underlying bonds were very highly rated, and the risk of default was viewed as extremely remote. Finally, the credit default swap business had, since its inception in the late 1990s, generated a reliable and steady source of income for AIGFP. In fact, AIGFP intended to retain its derivative interest in these highly rated bonds until they reached maturity. When the credit market seized up, like many other financial institutions, we were forced to mark our swap positions at fire sale prices as if we owned the underlying bonds, even though we believed that our swap positions had value if held to maturity. The company nevertheless began reporting billions of dollars of unrealized losses on the basis of then current market valuations. Suddenly, a company with $1 trillion of assets was reporting unrealized losses on its income statement that ultimately climbed into the tens of billions. As AIG's reported losses mounted, there was a domino-like series of repercussions. Although we had raised approximately $20 billion in capital, it appears that even this precaution was not sufficient protection in the face of the overwhelming and unprecedented market crisis that exists today. AIG nevertheless suffered credit rating downgrades, which triggered billions of dollars in collateral calls leading to the most recent events. Of course, by the time the board was presented with the federal plan, I had been out of the company for 3 months. In fact, just last week, both the Securities Exchange Commission and this Congress recognized the effects of FAS 157. The SEC recognize that FAS 157 can have unintended consequences for financial institutions when markets seize up. The SEC has attempted to provide more flexibility for companies operating and reporting under the rule. In the recently passed legislation, Congress directs the SEC to further examine mark-to-market accounting and grants the SEC authority to suspend mark-to-market accounting requirements. These measures make a lot of sense to me. I have spent my entire adult life in service to AIG, and I am heartbroken as to what has happened. I hope to see the company, and indeed the entire global economy, emerge from this crisis. I hope that my testimony today has been helpful to the committee, and I will do my very best to answer any questions you may have. Thank you, sir.
Thank you very much, Mr. Sullivan. Mr. Willemstad.
Good morning, Chairman Waxman, Ranking Member Davis, and members of the committee. AIG remains a great company, and I want to stress that AIG's problems never threatened AIG's policyholders. The crisis that required AIG to accept assistance from the Federal Reserve is a crisis in confidence that has affected the entire global economy. When I became CEO of AIG in June of this year, the decline in the U.S. housing market had already been underway for months. Though most homeowners were still making their mortgage payments, there was an unexpected and unprecedented breakdown in the market for mortgage-backed securities that were held by many banks and other financial institutions. Mark-to-market accounting rules forced AIG, along with Citigroup, Merrill Lynch, and others, to book tens of billions of dollars in accounting losses. By the end of the second quarter of 2008, AIG had booked $50 billion of losses. AIG was downgraded by the major rating agencies in early May, and AIG's stock price fell from a high in 2007 of $72 per share to $26 per share this June. This decline occurred despite raising $20 billion in new capital and the vigorous actions of AIG's board and Martin Sullivan before I became CEO. In June 2008, the board asked me to replace Martin Sullivan as CEO. I was initially reluctant to do so. However, the board ultimately persuaded me that my experience in the financial services industry, including my time as president and chief operating officer of Citigroup, put me in a position to lead AIG in this difficult period. On my first day as CEO, I publicly announced that I would present my plan for AIG in 90 days. It became apparent that if the markets continued to decline and if AIG were further downgraded by the rating agencies, AIG could potentially face a liquidity problem. I met with the rating agencies in July, and they told me they would not review AIG's ratings until after I announced our plan, which was then scheduled for September 25th. Even so, I immediately took steps to cut expenses and further protect AIG in the event of a liquidity problem. We identified non-strategic businesses, retained financial advisors, and began the process of selling those businesses to raise cash. To conserve cash, we stopped discussions relating to a number of acquisitions. We were negotiating a transaction with Berkshire Hathaway that would have protected billions of dollars of AIG's liquidity. In late July, I met with the president of the Federal Reserve Bank of New York to discuss the situation. These were precautionary steps. Through the first week of September, we believed AIG could weather the difficulties in the financial markets. When the market meltdown began the week of September 8th, the rating agencies indicated they would no longer wait to review AIG's ratings until September 25th. AIG was in a vicious circle. The rating agencies were considering a downgrade, largely because of market-driven liquidity concerns. But it was a downgrade, or the threat of one, that would trigger a liquidity crisis. We worked around the clock during the week of September 8th to take measures that would provide AIG the liquidity needed to make it through the crisis. But the private markets simply could not provide enough liquidity. On September 9th, I met again with the Federal Reserve Bank, and during the rest of the week, I stayed in contact with the Federal Reserve and the Treasury Department. On Tuesday, September 16, 2008, AIG was preparing for the unthinkable, bankruptcy. That afternoon, the Federal Reserve and the Treasury Department told AIG They would provide the necessary liquidity because an AIG bankruptcy would have massive negative effects on the stability of the entire financial system. The terms of the offer were non-negotiable. After a long discussion and with the advice of counsel and our financial advisors, the AIG Board of Directors accepted the Federal Reserve's plan as the best available option. As part of that plan, I was asked by the Treasury Department and the Federal Reserve to step down as CEO, and I did so. Looking back on my time as CEO, I don't believe AIG could have done anything differently. The credit default swap contracts had been in place for years. The market seizure was an unprecedented global catastrophe. We and our advisors explored every avenue. There was no private market solution to AIG's situation. I regret the pain that events in the market have caused AIG employees and its shareholders. I'm grateful that the Treasury and the Federal Reserve, and most importantly, the American people, offered their assistance to preserve a vital part of the financial system and a great American institution. Because my three-month tenure as Chief Executive Officer did not provide the opportunity to execute my restructuring plan, and in light of the fact that AIG shareholders and employees have lost so much value, I've notified the company I do not intend to accept the payments available to me under the AIG severance plan. Thank you.
Thank you both very much. We're now going to have questions from members of the panel. And without objection, the chairman and the ranking member will be allotted 10 minutes each to use as they see fit. Without objection, that will be the order. Both of you seem to be saying that these events had nothing to do with your management. It had to do with a tsunami of activities over which you had no control. And we're trying to assess whether that's true or whether there was mismanagement by the executives at AIG. Now, I want to submit for the record a disturbing letter that I've received from Joseph St. Dennis. He's a very reputable man. He was an assistant chief accountant at the SEC Enforcement Division. He was hired by AIG to address material weaknesses cited by AIG's auditors and to provide greater visibility and control with respect to the operations and accounting policy process of AIG FP. Mr. St. Dennis says that in 2007, and without objection, his letter will be made part of the record. He says in 2007, he became concerned about the valuation model used by AIG's financial products division. But when he tried to audit this division, he was blocked by Mr. Cassano, who was the head of that division. Mr. St. Dennis wrote the committee that the only, what Mr. Cassano said is that, I've deliberately excluded you from the valuation of the super seniors because I was concerned that you would pollute the process. That's what Mr. Cassano said to Mr. St. Dennis. And Mr. St. Dennis said to the committee, the only pollution Mr. Cassano was concerned about was the transparency I brought to AIG FP's accounting policy process. Mr. Sullivan, you were the CEO at the time, and Mr. St. Dennis was hired to give you insight into Mr. Cassano's activities. And he said he was blocked from doing that, and he resigned. Were you aware of this?
To the very best of my knowledge, sir, I don't believe I ever saw the letter, but I do recall the contents being brought to my attention, and I understand that a very thoughtful investigation, both from our compliance people and from, I believe, the audit committee, I'm not sure on that, but certainly our compliance and legal people looked into what Mr. St. Dennis was saying. Of course, at that time, we were already putting in place compensating controls to make sure that our valuation process was obviously accurate. And
well, you were trying to put these controls in, but the man who was hired by your company to give you the information as to what controls you needed was fired because he was told he couldn't look into what was happening in this particular division of AIG, the FP division, which from which all the problems seem to arise.
Well, from the very little I know about Mr. St. Dennis, and I have no reason to believe he's not a first-class individual, I think he resigned, sir. I don't think he was terminated. I think he actually...
No, he resigned because he was blocked from doing his job.
Exactly. And I think, you know, as I said, from what I recall about the letter, it was investigated by the legal and compliance people. But at the same time, obviously, we were trying to put compensating controls in there to make sure that our results were as accurate as possible.
Well, he said he reported Mr. Cassano's actions to AIG's independent auditors. He also said that he spoke with AIG's Director of Internal Audit, Michael Romer. Mr. Romer thought this was a serious matter, and on November 6, 2007, he personally briefed the Board's Audit Committee on Mr. St. Dennis's resignation, according to minutes for that meeting. Mr. Willemstad, you were the Chairman of the Board at this time. What steps did you and the Board take to investigate this matter?
I actually don't remember the comments in the Audit Committee.
You don't remember it?
I do not.
Okay. Well, we don't have a full record before the committee, but we did request all the minutes of the Audit Committee, and there's nothing we can see that indicates that AIG took any action to respond to Mr. St. Dennis's concerns. So it looks like you both brushed it aside. Is that an unfair characterization?
I don't recall the Audit Committee or the comments, so I can't answer that.
And you were the Chairman of the Board at the time?
I was.
And Mr. Sullivan, you were the CEO, and you don't have much recollection of this either.
No, other than I believe I recall that it was investigated by the legal compliance and, as you referred to, the Internal Audit Division, sir. Okay.
Well, the reason, of course, this is significant is that this man was brought in to find out about these kinds of problems, which ended up bringing AIG to its knees, and he could have given you that information, except he was blocked by the fellow in London, Mr. Cassano, who didn't want him to know what Mr. Cassano was up to. So I just find that very disturbing. I'm going to reserve the balance of my time and recognize Mr. Davis.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Mr. Sullivan, according to the documents obtained by the committee on March 11, 2008, it was recommended that losses at AIG FP not be considered when calculating your compensation package. How do you justify this while also advocating pay for performance as a prudential standard for executive compensation?
Well, first of all, sir, can I just clarify that my compensation was obviously discussed in executive session with the Compensation Committee, and they ultimately made a recommendation to the Board at large, who ultimately had to approve my compensation. From what I can recall, and if you're referring, it would be helpful if I could know the minutes that you're referring to, but some were put up on the screen earlier. But if you're referring to the discussions we had on the senior partners and the partners plan, is that what you're referring to, sir?
We asked the staff to get that on. I'll go on for another question.
Well, I'm happy to.
I was just looking at your resume, so I saw that you went to the Sidney Russell School and were very generous to them afterwards. Did you have further education after that?
I put myself through night school, sir, and became a chartered insurer. I received my associateship of the Chartered Insurance Institute in the United Kingdom.
Okay. And you joined AIG in 1971?
Yes, sir, when I was 17.
So when you were 17 years old. Mr. Willemstad, can you tell us how the market-to-market accounting rules affected AIG's position, and do you think it contributed to the deterioration of the company?
Well, I'd like to make a couple of comments. I have no concern or problem.
Could you move that closer to the microphone just so I can hear you? Thank you.
I'd make a couple of comments about mark-to-market. One, I have no concerns about the validity of mark-to-market accounting. I think the concerns that I've shared in my written statement is that when there is no market, the ability to value securities based on FAS 157 becomes somewhat difficult and requires a fair amount of judgment. There are, as I said, no specific market for these securities. And the company, along with others, have to go through a process which uses formulas and other indicative prices to come up with these values. So accordingly, it's very difficult to determine whether the values are actually correct. According to the procedures that AIG followed, There were very substantial write-downs in these securities.
So did it help or hurt you?
Well, it obviously resulted in substantial write-downs, which were obviously not helpful to the company.
Your statement alludes to the fact that in 2005, AIG stopped writing policies on multi-sector credit default swaps. So somebody, I guess, at AIG saw that there were problems or questions with this portion of the business. Why did AIG stop writing these policies?
I don't know. I was not on the board at that time.
Sullivan, do you know why?
Sorry, sir.
In Mr. Lumsted's statement, he talked about that AIG in 2005 stopped writing policies on multi-sector credit default swaps. Obviously, they did that. Somebody recommended this inside, and this was an early warning signal. Can you tell us?
Yeah, from the best of my recollection, based on what I've understood, because obviously at that time I was very focused on resolving the regulatory issues that AIG was facing and making sure that we got our accounts issued. Obviously, there was a big delay in 2005 in our issuing our accounts. From what I understand on investigation, that decision was made by AIG FP in conjunction with the risk management, the chief risk officer and the chief credit officer of AIG.
So they saw a problem, obviously.
They saw, from what I understand, they saw a deterioration in pricing and were beginning to get concerned about credit quality. So they took a very proactive step in 2005.
Did AIG rely heavily on the mortgage-backed assets of Fannie Mae and Freddie Mac, and did their demise play a role?
I don't know the answer to that, sir.
Okay. Is there any linkage between AIG and the GSEs in terms of what was happening with Freddie and Fannie buying these with implied government backing?
I'm not aware of what our exposure was to Freddie or Fannie off the top of my head, sir.
Okay. I have your statement up here on the board. Now I'll ask you.
Yeah. Thank you for putting that up here. I appreciate that. When I was talking to the Compensation Committee on March 11th, what I was proposing there was what they should actually award the partners and the senior partners. And I think, as somebody mentioned earlier, there were 700 partners, and there were about 70 senior partners. And I was making a recommendation. And by the way, I should stress, nobody in AIG FP participated in this partners plan or senior partners plan. And what obviously I was anxious to do is to make sure that we retained our key people. Obviously, our shareholders would expect me to be focused on retaining our key people in those parts of the business, the insurance businesses and other sectors of the businesses that were performing well whilst these unrealized losses, but nonetheless losses. Nobody's differentiating between unrealized and losses.
What you're saying is in these sectors, they were meeting their goals, they were doing their job.
Yes,
in other sectors,
not everybody was hitting targets. Some were exceeding, some were not exceeding, as you would expect in a business. But what I was anxious to do is to make sure that we retained the 700 key executives that were running other parts of our business and participating in other parts of our business and were not in AIG FP. The important distinction there is nobody in AIG FP participated in these programs.
Mr. Olmsted, you don't see any relation between what was happening at Freddie and Fannie and what was happening with AIG then? Do you agree with Mr. Sullivan there? He didn't.
I do not.
Okay. Did the accounting scandals there raise a red flag that you were insuring investments that could be tainted that were coming out of there?
I'm sorry, could you?
Did the fact that the you were getting into some of the business, did the accounting scandals at Fannie and Freddie raise any red flag as to whether you were insuring investments that might be tainted?
No.
Okay. Do you think the rating? Okay, I'll move on. Let's take you both to the early 2000 time frame. Is there anything in government regulation going back to this early time frame that would have changed your business model and would have prevented this catastrophe? You were somewhere else at that point.
That's correct.
Lumsted, but Citigroup. Mr. Sullivan.
Can I just clarify? You mentioned the year 2000.
Yeah.
So, what maybe it's helpful
in that time frame. Yes,
maybe it's helpful for the committee there. But from the best of my knowledge, the CDS portfolio started to be underwritten in the late 90s, 1998. And obviously, as I testified,
but the rules were changing as we speak. What happened in that time frame, of course, is you had several rule changes taking place at Congress statutorily.
What, if you're referring to my comments regarding FAS 157 in particular?
I'm talking about the regulatory framework on the commodities futures, on Glass-Steagall repeal, those kind of things.
Right. I don't think anything in the regulatory field, to the very best of my knowledge, would have changed what occurred. You're going back to 1998.
That's what I'm asking.
Yeah, I don't.
Okay. I'll reserve the balance of my time for now.
Mr. Sullivan, just so I have this correct, you asked that your bonus based on performance not count the losses at AIGFP. Is that right?
No, sir. What I was referring to here was what should be paid under our partners and senior partners plan.
And you were included in that group.
I was included in that, but at the time I was speaking.
So everybody in that group, including you, got the bonuses as if you performed very well because you didn't count the losses.
No, but with respect, sir, the compensation committee of our board sets my remuneration, and it's then discussed at the board of large. They could have.
Requested the board to take that position.
On behalf of the employees of AIG, yes, sir.
Including yourself.
But I was focusing on them more than me.
And the AIGFP, they were getting paid bonuses that were even higher than the bonuses you were getting. Isn't that correct?
In certain instances, yes, sir. In most instances.
So everybody did really well, even though there were losses. You didn't get penalized, you and the others you represented, you didn't get penalized because of the losses, even though your bonus was dependent on getting a bonus higher if you got earnings, higher bonus. You got lower earnings, and therefore you still got the bonus. And AIGFP got their bonuses because they were being handled in a different way, even though they were the ones bringing on the losses. Is that a fair statement?
Just for clarity, sir, with regard to my bonus, it was substantially reduced in 2007 by AIG's board of directors, which I concurred with. With regard to AIGFP, I don't believe, and again, this is from the very best of my recollection, that they received their bonuses in 2007. I think we put in place a deferred compensation plan. Again, I'm doing this from memory. But they certainly received their bonuses for 2006 and prior.
Okay. Thank you. Ms. Maloney?
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. We heard from our first panel that one of the key factors that caused this financial mess was not accounting rules that shed light on these risky, exotic tools that you are investing in have no value and that people don't want to buy them. What the first panel said was that one of the key factors was inadequate regulation of so-called credit default swaps. And it is a $58 trillion market, double the size of the entire New York Stock Exchange. The market is four times larger than our national debt. But unlike the stock exchange, the swap market has no transparency, no rules, and no oversight. The result of the failure to regulate these credit default swaps seems pretty clear. AIG had to be bailed out by the taxpayers because of your risky investment in credit default swaps. And I, for one, don't think any of the management deserves a bonus or any pay from the taxpayer's purse, and certainly not an exotic weekend to discuss the future of AIG, which was a great company. You have cost my constituents and the taxpayers of this country $85 billion and run into the ground one of the most respected insurance companies in the history of our country. And the company's failure has tremendous implications in our entire economy. I got hundreds of calls from constituents concerned about AIG because of their interaction with this company. So I would like first to ask you, Mr. Sullivan, do you believe the swaps market should be regulated?
Well, obviously, with the benefit of considerable hindsight, if there is good regulation that can be put in place, personally, I would support that.
Mr. Wilmstead, do you believe that the swap market should be regulated?
Yes.
Could you give to this committee how much AIG lost in these swaps? Do you have any idea? Out of the $85 trillion, how much is held by AIG? Could you get us back in writing? Maybe that's something you need to look at. Yeah. Now, I'd like to also ask you, Mr. Sullivan, that if the same rules that had applied to your insurance company, where you had backup and some reserves, would this have avoided the bailout that AIG is confronting now?
Well, Congresswoman, at the time I left the company, I believed it was well capitalized and had the liquidity to work its
but
way
the
through.
But the swaps had no capital behind them.
Well, but the
did
point
the swaps have any capital behind them?
Well, only the capital ultimately of AIG, I believe. So.
Pardon me?
Only the capital ultimately of the holding company.
I'm talking about the swaps. There was no capital reserve behind the swaps, right? So you were just gambling billions, possibly trillions of dollars.
Well, I wouldn't refer to it as gambling. I would, these transactions were individually underwritten very carefully, and maybe I can provide some more background to you that may be helpful.
If they were carefully underwritten, how come no one wants to buy them? And our first panel said, when you securitize them the first time, maybe the second time they had value, but when you get to the sixth and seventh time, that there's no value there. Yeah. That's what the first panel said.
Well,
and you did not follow the insurance rules of having any collateral or capital behind these risky swaps.
Yeah, maybe it would be helpful, because there was a lot of generalization in the first panel. Maybe it would be helpful if I just explain. And as I say, I'm not an accountant.
But you did
economist.
Make a good decision not to sell them anymore after 2005.
Well, to accept any more swaps after 2005. But
so you must have realized they didn't have any value. And what I'm angry about now is when you blame accountants for coming forward, looking at a product and saying it has no value because absolutely no one in the entire world wants to buy it. It's not their fault. You want them to say there's value there when there's none? I believe in the fair market value. If no one wants to buy it, I think there's an indication that there's no value there, that you are generating fees, making all of your employees rich, wrecking a great company, and tearing down our economy, and now turning to the taxpayers and asking us to bail you out. I think you should be apologizing to the American people for your mismanagement.
Well, maybe it would be helpful if I can. First of all, I'm not blaming accountants. I said in my testimony.
You said the mark-to-market rules, which is how accountants determine whether there is fair market value. They have determined no one wants to buy it. Therefore, it does not have fair market value. That I believe they're shedding light on the problem. And there have been many memos from many executives saying they should change the accounting rules and say there's value there when there is no value.
Gentlelady's time has expired. Do you want to make any comment?
May I answer, sir?
Yes.
With the utmost respect, what I said in my testimony was the unintended consequences of FAS 157. I have never staged criticized FAS 157. My concern, which ultimately the SEC and this Congress have concurred with, when I made my remarks, I started making these remarks back in March of this year, was the unintended consequences of trying to mark to market these assets in an illiquid market. And one of the concerns I had, if I may, again, which may be educational, is back many years ago, many of you may recall that Piper Alpha exploded in the North Sea. I mean, if you remember the tragic circumstances of Piper Alpha exploding, there was something in the London market insurance area that was called the London market spiral. And what Piper Alpha precipitated was a spiraling effect throughout the market that forced the market ultimately to collapse. The London market insurance spiral is no longer there. What I saw in early 2008 was what I believe was an unintended consequence of FAS 157. I wasn't attempting in any way, shape, or form to criticize it. What I was trying to bring to everybody's attention, and what I'm trying to bring to everybody's attention today, was the unintended consequence of trying to mark-to-market assets that had value, that you were happy to hold to maturity, that interest was being paid, dividends were being paid, but you couldn't mark-to-market in an illiquid market. And that was, with the greatest respect, the point I was trying to make. I don't think there's any one individual, any one entity, any one body that you can point the finger to. I think when you look back and seeing these great institutions that we're addressing today and this committee has addressed in the past, if you look at the German government guaranteeing bank deposits, you look at the Irish government.
Mr. Sullivan, we're going to have more questions on this.
I'm terribly sorry, sir, but I'm trying to bring it into perspective, if I may. I'm not trying to point the finger at accountants or FAS 157. I'm trying to raise the issue of unintended consequences. Thank you.
Mr. Davis, you wanted to
I yield myself a couple of minutes because I'm still puzzled by both of your comments about not relying on Freddie and Fannie. My understanding is people would buy these secondary mortgages, and you would say you would sell them credit default swaps. Isn't that what happened?
Yes, selling, to the very best of my knowledge, so we're senior credit.
But you weren't relying on the fact that this government-backed group was insuring them and that it had bought them originally. That had nothing. Now, let me just tell you where I'm going with this. In documents submitted to the committee, a former AIG CEO, Hank Greenberg, asserts that in the 8 years from 1998 to March 2005, AIG wrote credit default swaps on only about 200 CDOs. Those are collateralized debt obligations. Only a handful, he says, of these were exposed to subprime mortgages. He goes on to assert that after his departure from AIG, the company under your leadership, Mr. Sullivan, wrote about 200 CDO credit default swaps in just 10 months from March to December 2005, but that these, unlike his CDOs, were heavily exposed to subprime mortgages. Essentially, as I read it, Mr. Greenberg is blaming you for exposing AIG to the most risky credit default swaps. Do you agree with that assertion or not?
Clearly not, sir. But what I again would point out that these CDS swaps were being written since the late 90s. You know, not just in 2005.
Well, I know they were written in the 90s, but my question here is, he's saying that in the early stages it was not heavy on subprimes. That after this it became very heavy with subprime. You claim Freddie and Fannie have nothing to do with this, is what I heard you saying. You weren't relying on the fact that they were buying these up and that they had government back. So, but you went ahead with this, according to Mr. Greenberg, and that in the 10 months before you stopped, on the alarm went out, that you were buying these up, and that he says but that's basically what put you risky credit default swaps. In fact, in earlier testimony from Mr. Wilmstead, he notes that the FP wrote a large number of instruments called credit default swaps over time, that they wrote insurance-like swaps on bonds with a face value of over $500 billion. Is that correct?
From recollection, I don't believe the number got to $500 billion, but it was certainly in totality around $400 billion, yes.
And what are they actually worth?
Well, that's the notional value, sir. Let me just point out, if I may, as up until the time I left AIG, to the very best of my knowledge, AIG had not suffered $1 realized loss.
Right. You're still holding them, aren't they? They're still holding them.
Yeah. And, you know, at the time, this valuation can come back. As these contracts mature, and they have an average tenor of 4 or 5 years, as these contracts mature, the valuation, assuming there is no loss under the contract, the valuations would come back.
But you carry them on the books at zero.
Well, I'm not sure they're carried at zero, sir. They're marked to market at the valuation. But coming back to the point of 2005, I don't want to underestimate the fact that AIG was in a different sort of crisis in 2005. We had advised the market that they couldn't rely on our accounts. We have major regulatory issues that were dominating the focus of my attention. I had to negotiate with the SEC, the DOJ, my friends at the New York Insurance Department, as well as the New York Attorney General. And we had to stabilize a ship that could have come very much unglued. During that process of time, obviously, the Capital Markets Division, i.e. AIGFP, continued to write their business. Nobody had, had any concerns about the profitability of that business at the time. And as they progressed through 2005, as the Congresswoman said, fortunately, You know, those people involved in the underwriting of that, including the corporate risk and corporate credit officers, you know, made the determination that the market was deteriorating not only in pricing but in credit quality, and made the decision, fortunately, to stop. And that's the point I'd like to make. But the day I left the company, sir, all of these losses, to the very best of my knowledge, were unrealized at the time. Nonetheless, losses,
yeah,
but unrealized.
Thank you, Mr. Davis. Mr. Cummings?
Yeah, thank you very much, Mr. Chairman. Mr. Sullivan, are you like Mr. Wilmstadt, considering giving back some of that money?
No, I'm not, sir.
All righty. After the bailout on September 16th, the taxpayers, in effect, became the owners of AIG. That should have meant a change in its approach to executive compensation and benefits, but apparently it did not. The committee has learned that a week after the bailout, executives from AIG's main U.S. life insurance subsidiary, AIG American General, held this week-long conference at an exclusive resort in California. Are you all familiar? Are you familiar with that at all?
I am not.
All righty. The resort is called the St. Regis Monarch Beach Resort. We've gotten some pictures and we put them up. And let me give you a sense of how exclusive the resort was. Rooms started at $425. Some cost as much as $1,200. And it's interesting. They've got 5 nights. They had a room for a presidential suite for $1,600. And then they had 5 nights, the Royal Suite, really nice and swanky, another $1,600 for 5 nights. That was $8,000. And we contacted the resort and we got a copy of the bill. AIG spent $200,000, $200,000, Mr. Sullivan, for rooms, and $150,000 for banquets. They spent the $23,000 for the hotel spa. I don't know whether you heard me asking the experts of questions earlier, and of course that was for the pedicures, manicures, facials, massages, and whatever they do in the spa. And they spent about $1,400 at the salon. The guests at in the spa salon actually had different amenities. They had all kinds of things at St. Regis, but they spent $7,000 on something very, very important, that is green fees at the golf course. And then I'm not even sure what this charge means, but my colleagues tell me that the $10,000 for leisure dining was for drinking. Mr. Wilmstadt, you're no longer a CEO, and I understand that. When this all happened, what's your opinion? You seem to be a very honorable man. Would you have gone along with that?
Absolutely not.
And what do you think of it?
It seems very inappropriate.
And it seems it's a very bad thing when you think about the fact that the United States taxpayers would be basically ending up paying for this. Is that not correct?
I'm not aware of the facts, but I'll take your word for it.
But could you understand why taxpayers would be upset?
Of course.
And, Mr. Sullivan, I'm curious, what were your views on this?
Well, obviously, I share Mr. Wilmstadt's comments there. You know, obviously, I left the company many months earlier, prior to Mr. Wilmstadt. But if I'd have seen bills like that, I can assure you, as the CEO, I would have been asking questions.
And
but at the time I left, AIG, within its travel department, had a unit that organized conferences that was supposed to obviously get the best rates and make sure that the conferences were being held in appropriate locations. This is obviously some months later. So,
But you can understand why taxpayers would be very upset, wouldn't you? Couldn't you?
Yes, sir.
I want to contact the AIG to find out who was responsible for all of this, because I think that person ought to be fired, don't you?
Well, without knowing the full facts, you may reach that conclusion when you reach those facts, but I don't know the facts, sir. I'd left many months earlier.
One of the experts earlier said that they wanted to make sure these kind of things did not happen again. What kind of, now that we, the taxpayers of America, are part of this process, what kind of things and procedures can we put in place to make sure these kinds of things don't happen again?
Well, I think you have to look, and I think with respect, Mr. Donello mentioned this at the time, you need to look at for what purpose is this conference being used. You know, obviously the company at that stage had gone through a transition maybe they believed it was an appropriate thing to calm everybody down. I think Mr. Denholm made some reference to that. But as you look at going forward as a manager, you would look at the appropriateness of, one, what's the reason for the conference? Is it appropriate? And what's the benefit to the company? And what's the appropriate cost that should be associated with that, as you would do with any management expense?
I do find it interesting that Mr. Willemstad knows nothing about it. But this came just a week after you left. Did you know that, Mr. Willemstad?
I heard you say that, but I was totally unaware that there was any plan for any conference.
So you wouldn't have been aware of this subsidiary spending some $500,000.
I was not aware of it.
In a week.
I was not aware of it, and had I been aware of it, I would have prevented it from happening.
Thank you very much.
Thank you. One of the big frustrations that anybody watching this across America has is, both of you used the term market-driven, financial tsunami, as if you weren't part of it. Do you feel you have any responsibility for what's happened in our economy with a huge company that the taxpayers now have put $61 billion in with 85 going? Do you feel you have any personal responsibility? Mr. Sullivan?
Well, sir, may I say, I take responsibility for everything that occurred, as my tenure as AIG's president and chief executive. And that's the role of a president and chief executive to take
responsibility. In other words, you're acting like during your period, you were doing fine, you're having all these nice profits, and that somewhere between July and September, your company lost $61 billion that we've already had to bail out. And you're claiming that the accounting rule, which was the law, it was just a matter of interpretation of how to apply it, and I basically don't agree with how it was enforced, and like many others have argued that that was a wrong enforcement. But quite frankly, what it did was it showed up that your assets didn't have great value. And do you acknowledge that you are part what triggered the financial tsunami? That your risky strategies in your company. Let me ask you another question. Your insurance division is fine, correct?
To the very best of my knowledge, at the time I left, certainly.
I misplaced your name here. But Mr. Willemstad, wouldn't you say your financial division, we heard earlier, your financial division appears to be in good shape? I mean, your insurance division.
That's correct.
Now, if your insurance division is in good shape, it means that this is concentrated in your financial services division. And your insurance division, which is also investing assets, chose not to invest in as risky assets that didn't yield as much but were less risky. Is that not true? Or how would you explain that one division in a short period of time could have had $61 billion in taxpayer investment and your other division not needing it when your other division, as insurance companies do, also invest in properties, also have been struggling with mark-to-market, have also had, but have more regulation on the value of those assets prior to that decision? Why does not your risky strategies in the financial services show that, in fact, to get higher return, you went for more risk in that category? Mr. Sullivan?
Thank you, sir. Well, again, what I'd like to point out is that we actually stopped running that business, thank goodness, in 2005. And that's a point I'd like to, because I don't think it was made clear in the first session that fortunately we'd been in that business for some 10 years. But as my colleagues determined that the credit quality was changing and the pricing of these super senior credit defaults.
So let me clarify, because you've referred to this several times. Are you saying that the $61 billion that we put in is mostly with things that were pre-2005?
Well, I don't know what the $61 million is.
$61 billion is what the taxpayers have already put in of the 85 to cover the losses of AIG. Right. And are you maintaining that this is just to rescue bad decisions pre-2005, or is any of that money because you had questionable decisions between 2005 and 2008? Do you bear any responsibility? That's what I'm asking.
Well, I want to be clear. I'd say you responsibility for everything that occurred under my tenure.
You said you were making profits a little bit ago. You said that you were making profits, that you hadn't lost any money. Yeah, but you had a shell that was anchored in less than secured mortgages that had been leveraged multiple times. Your insurance division, which also presumably has mortgages and other types of investment, it seems fine. The question is why weren't you warning your stockholders? Why weren't you making declarations that you would leave your company? I mean, I have a business background, an MBA, just a small-town business guy, but at the same time, you took incredible risk without warning people, and the evidence of that risk is that one accounting, by your own explanation, one accounting rules change put your company under, and the taxpayers are putting $61 billion in. How in the world does an executive leave their company so vulnerable that when they leave, all of a sudden they go broke when they were claiming they were making money before, and they act astounded like, well, everything was just fine if they hadn't done this one accounting rule? I agree that you have to balance out when the assets are going to be sold. I understand that. You're holding them long term. But the reason they're trying to do some of this kind of thing is we might have had a complete collapse if we hadn't done any mark-to-market here, if we hadn't done any of these kind of accounting changes. Our assets were deteriorating, and we would have had an even bigger blow-up later, potentially. We needed some kind of a mix in there. But in effect, you left your company so exposed that when a little bit of softness came to the economy and it started down and they do an accounting change, you go belly up and stick everybody else in America with it, and you're saying, oh, it was a market tsunami, as if you didn't help cause it.
Ken, if I may, sir, with the utmost respect, I'm in my testimony, if I emphasize FAS 157 as being the only cause, it was not, again, with the greatest respect, I was not criticizing FAS 157. I was referring to its unintended consequences, which, of course, this Congress has now and the SEC have now recognized. There were many other reasons that have affected many other companies and many other countries around the world. It's not just the United States. You know, this tsunami that many have referred to, others have mentioned, the equivalent of a financial Pearl Harbor, you know, much more intelligent people than I. You know, there were many issues that, you know, contributed to this. As I mentioned, you know, whether it was inappropriate lending or borrowing, whether it was, lack of investor confidence, whether it was, the freezing of the credit markets. I just, in my testimony, to be helpful to the committee, focused on, what I believe back in my tenure as AIG, something that I was concerned about, which was the unintended consequences of FAS 157. And as I responded to the Congressman earlier, at the time I left, whilst, as Mr. Williamstad articulated in his testimony, we had taken substantial unrealized losses nonetheless. But at the end of the day, these CDS transactions, at the time I had left the company, had not incurred, to the very best of my knowledge, $1 of realized. Now, that's not to say they wouldn't, as the situation progressed. But what I at the time I left the company, this was a multiple issues, not one entity, not one individual. And that was the point I was trying to make. If I referred to FAS 157 too much in my testimony, it was only because that was something that I was particularly concerned about, as not being an accountant, but as, again, like you, sir, a businessman.
Gentlemen's time has expired.
I'm terribly
sorry. I yield one minute to the ranking member.
I guess the thing that to all of us is puzzled is how come you get bailed out, Lehman doesn't, who makes these choices at the Treasury? Kind of mysterious, I think, to a lot of us. The regrettable thing here is that you get bailed out, your employees get to stay, your shareholders take a bath, but you're bailed out because there would be a lot of collateral damage if we were to have not stepped in. That's at least the rationale that we're hearing from Treasury. But frankly, given the quality of some of the decisions that were made, you deserve to fail. And it is, I think, for a lot of us puzzling why you were singled out and were kept your doors open, your employees kept moving, while other companies were left to fail and just fall on their sword. And I think that's what's troubling to me, and I think to a lot of other members up here. And I think we'll explore more of that in the testimony and the questions as we follow. Thank you.
Thank you. The chair recognizes Congressman Kucinich for 5 minutes.
I thank the gentlelady It appears that in the last month this country has taken steps, unprecedented circumstances, unprecedented steps. We interfered in the free market. We bailed out Wall Street. The market is not responding. We see today's headline in the Wall Street Journal, markets fall on doubts rescues will succeed. And I think what this does is I think it raises questions as to whether it was wise for government to intervene directly into markets and whether or not a financial rescue plan should have addressed the core problem, which is tens of millions of Americans losing their homes, needing government to get a controlling interest in these mortgage-backed securities so that we can work out a plan where people can get a break on the interest rates, on their principal, extended terms of their loan, and help people save their loans. We have other choices of priming the pump of the economy. We didn't do any of that. Now, questions are raised. For example, you talk about mark-to-market. AIG went into the government's hands on about September 18th. Interesting, mark-to-market was basically suspended on the 30th. I think the timing of that needs to be explored a little bit more carefully. We know it went into effect on the 15th of November. We've got a bailout plan by the Secretary of the Treasury, which is clearly not working, and we've got, which the taxpayers are paying for, and we've got another $85 billion of a bailout for AIG. And according to the testimony submitted to this committee by a former CEO of AIG, Mr. Greenberg, he raises questions as to whether or not a government bailout of AIG was absolutely necessary. In fact, he admits there was a liquidity crisis that required action, but he goes on to say in his testimony the action was, it was not necessary to do a government bailout. He said that it was not necessary to wipe out virtually all the shareholder value held by AIG's millions of shareholders, including tens of thousands of employees and many more pensioners and other Americans on fixed income. He said that perhaps they could have filed bankruptcy, limited the parent company, and that millions of stockholders would have fared better. This goes back to a question of my friend, that the stockholders would have fared better. But he says that other stakeholders, like AIG's Wall Street counterparties, would have fared worse. So according to the testimony of another CEO of AIG, private sector solutions for AIG were rejected. He talked about the tens of billions of capital that that were offered. He talked about the state of New York ready to permit AIG to use $20 billion in excess capital in its insurance subsidiaries. Plus, he says there was no effort made for a temporary and limited bridge fund from the government. Plus, we have this market-to-market problem, and plus you have, without the market-to-market problem, you have possibly $1 trillion that could have been pledged to secure an instead of, you know, trying to secure an $85 billion loan from the government. Now, instead, the government takes over. AIG, now we have 80% of ownership of AIG. Here's what's going on with AIG. AIG's paying interest on undrawn capital. They're paying interest on money it doesn't borrow. The company is encouraged to draw down the full amount of the loan, even if it doesn't need the money. Now, in order to service the principal and loan, the AIG has to engage in a fire sale of profitable assets. Who buys those assets, Mr. Sullivan? Who buys AIG's assets?
Well, obviously, I can't comment on the events that.
Who buys their assets?
What if you recruit investment bankers, they will go out and, I assume, get the best deal that they possibly can for the assets for sale.
Mr. Willisted, you were involved in negotiations with Treasury Secretary Paulson. Why do you think AIG was bailed out while Lehman Brothers was allowed to fail?
I'm not sure why Lehman Brothers was allowed to fail. I think it was understood that the consequences to the financial system if AIG failed would be very significant.
My time's expired, madam.
The chair recognizes Congressman Bill Bray of California for 5 minutes.
Thank you, Madam Chair. You know, Madam Chair, I do an editorial note. I'm not going to ask you gentlemen from prepared statements that somebody else has written up before this hearing. I'm going to ask questions that basically respond to your testimony. Madam Chair, I do have to point out that it's sort of interesting the way we throw around terminologies. And somebody born and raised on the ocean spent some time in the water myself. I find it funny that we use the terminology like tsunami. We can't even use plain language like tidal wave. But maybe because some people don't understand some of the words they're using. Gentlemen, the term tsunami or tidal wave is not just a wave coming in. You landlubbers and people that don't surf may not understand that long before that crest breaks, there's an indication that something is going on. Granted, usually tourists see the tide going out and think it's a good time to go out and pick up seashells. And a lot of people seem to have seen that the tide shifting and the major changes that were happening were an opportunity to go in and clean up. And they got caught below the high water mark. I hope the chair doesn't mind me using that analogy, but as an old surfer, I just can't go past addressing that when Freddie and Fannie went from 30% to 70% of a certain part of the market. When we saw major portions of our oil money that's going overseas coming back and buying up paper and inflating a market, don't you think that we should have seen some concern there when we say, well, let me just ask it out. When Freddie and Fannie went to 30 to 70%, how much of the problem should have been seen by all of us that we have a portion of the market that was very, very vulnerable? And did that vulnerability have an effect to your operations and the problems we're facing with AIG, with Freddie and Fannie?
Would you like me to respond?
Yes.
First of all, I don't believe, with the greatest respect, I'm qualified to comment on Freddie and Fannie and the implications thereof. But what I did say in my testimony was, you know, one of the factors that, you know, I think has contributed to, and I, you know, the tsunami equivalent, I defer to your expertise, sir, but the, you know, what's contributed to what has impacted the global financial economy is, you know, one of the things could be, you know, inappropriate borrowing and lending. And if that correlates to your analogy of Freddie and Fannie, maybe that's helpful. I don't know. But I certainly don't know enough about Freddie and Fannie to pass any, you know, qualified opinion.
And I apologize. I had to fly back from the West Coast to be here at this hearing. I just got to look at the waves and didn't get to enjoy them at all this weekend. So we're here getting our job work done.
Yeah,
let's just talk about the mark to market. We developed a concept based on the Enron model of how to address Enron. Now, would you agree that when it applies to mortgage-backed securities, when there's real estate involved, the existing or the traditional accounting process with mark to market really didn't reflect the real value, the real assets, and the real situation on the ground, and gave an artificial appearance of volatility that scared the hell out of the market in a lot of ways that maybe it shouldn't have?
I would agree with that statement.
Yeah, as I testified, sir, I think what occurred was when FAS 157 and mark-to-market accounting was put in place, you know, it was really the ability to mark-to-market in a liquid market when there is no visible valuation. And again, maybe it's helpful if I can just give an example. It's like owning an apartment block, and the valuation of that apartment block goes up and down. But all of the tenants, you're the owner of that building, and you've got it fully occupied. Everybody's paying their rent on time. you can pay your mortgage and you can pay your any capital expense you have in repairs or whatever, and you don't have to sell that building. You can hold it for as long as you want, and it doesn't really matter what the valuation of that building is, because you can hold it and you're getting all the cash that you need in from that. And what's occurred in the illiquid markets is that you're trying to value assets that are still paying their rent, they're still providing you with the cash flow that you need, but there isn't a valuation that responds to that in an illiquid market. And that was the point. That's a very simplistic example, but that was the point I was trying to make about the unintended consequences.
So, in other words, our theory of trying to go in and correct the Enron, we need to go back and readdress it because we moved too far the other way, to where this doesn't reflect the reality. And I think that one of the things a lot of people were interested in those mortgage-backed securities, because they always knew that there was real estate involved, but the accounting process doesn't reflect that reality.
Well, I think obviously, as I said, it wasn't a criticism of FAS 157. I think there was an unintended consequence that I'm pleased that Congress and the SEC have agreed to at least take a look at.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman.
Gentlemen's time has expired. Mr. Tierney.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Gentlemen, I think people are a little bit baffled here. We look at Mr. Greenberg's testimony, and it's not his fault, according to him. It all happened after his watch. Mr. Sullivan, you say no mistakes were made as events unfolded. Mr. Willemstad, you say AIG couldn't have done any differently. And yet I think that people really expect that as the management of your company, you as the leaders of the company, would have seen what risk you were taking and been able to just know what they were and assess them. We took a look at the internal minutes from your audit committee meetings. They're not public, but we were able to get them. They seem to tell a different story on that. And let me just go down. On January 15th, the audit committee minutes say this: ongoing discussions revealed that PricewaterhouseCoopers believes to be an expectation gap among key parties, including the board, management, and the internal control functions. The next month, on February 7th, the audit committee meeting, PwC warns the role and reporting of risk management needs a higher profile at AIG. At a February 26th meeting, PwC says, indicated that the process at AIG seemed to break down. In that, unlike other companies, where there was a good dialogue and appropriate levels of management on the approach, alternatives considered, and key decisions, at AIG, only AIGFP, your financial products division, was involved in the December valuation process. And that may have something to do with the chairman's letter that he received from Mr. St. Denis, and that he brought it to people's attention and he couldn't get by that office over there. Then you have March 10th, 2008, you get the Office of Thrift Supervision. They weigh in on this, and they say that your management of the company and your oversight of AIG subsidiaries, including in particular the financial products division led by Mr. Cassano, should be criticized. And they also say that supervisory concerns regarding the corporate oversight of key AIG's subsidiaries exist, and they write that we are concerned that corporate oversight of AIG financial products lacks critical elements of independence, transparency, and granularity. And the next day, PricewaterhouseCoopers reports that there is a common control issue and root cause for these problems, and that AIG does not have the appropriate access or clarity around the roles and responsibilities of critical control functions. Gentlemen, that seems to stretch from January 15th all the way to March 11th. Your own internal audits, your own PricewaterhouseCoopers group, and the Office of Thrift Supervision repeatedly saying that serious lapses are there. They describe them. Both the auditors and the regulators, don't you think that management has some responsibility for what went on here? Mr. Willemstad?
Yes, management has some responsibility,
Mr.
I believe.
Mr. Sullivan, do you agree?
Yes, I would also say that at the same time, we were putting compensating controls in place. I mean, you've read the chronological list there, but we had put compensating controls in place that enabled us obviously to issue our financials for 2007 with a clean audit.
I guess the problem is people expect management to be ahead of the curve, not to wait for the regulators and PricewaterhouseCoopers to start blowing the whistle late. The salaries that you gentlemen pulled down, you and your team, on that, it means to us that you anticipate these things and that you start putting those things in place before the whistle is blown, before these people come in and point out the seriousness of the situation. And
I think that's what disturbs people on this, and what continues to be a theme through here, that it's not, and Mr. Chairman, I'd like unanimous consent to put copies of the audit reports in the minutes, as well as the Office of Thrift Supervision letter of March 10, 2008 in the record, because I think it shows clearly that this is not something that external factors are responsible for solely on this. There's a fundamental failure here of management, and I'm glad that you both take responsibility for it. I hope your whole management team does, because certainly the price is extremely high on that.
Without objection, those documents will be made part of the record.
Can I just respond on one point? So one of the things that we set out to do in March of 2005 was to make tremendous investments in a number of areas that previously been underinvested. So we'd added a lot of staff in internal audit, in legal, compliance, risk management, et cetera. So I wanted you to at least to know that there were compensating controls put in place.
And I appreciate that, if I may, Mr. Chairman, except that these are reports from January, February, and March of 2008. So obviously not enough had happened even remotely close to settling the comms of the regulators and the auditors on that. So I think to show some management issues there.
And if the gentleman will yield to me.
I will yield, Mr. Chairman.
And Mr. St. Denis, who was working for you to alert you to these problems, tried to get through in November of 2007, and neither of you remember him complaining or know anything about his concerns. So you did have an alarm even in the previous year. Mr. Turner, I think you're next.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Yesterday, we had a hearing concerning Lehman Brothers, and there was a discussion that Lehman Brothers had its own subprime lender, BNC Mortgage, I believe it was, where they were issuing subprime loans. With AIG, my understanding is that you were an insurer and you also traded mortgage-backed securities. I'm not certain, though. Did you also have a lending function of subprime mortgages? And also, then, did you package loans, issuing them, selling them as mortgage-backed securities? What in the subprime crisis that we're seeing, what activity in the subprime market did AIG have?
I'll respond to it. We did have a consumer, they do have, it's hard to differentiate when you've been there 37 years. AIG does have a consumer finance.
You have a lender.
It's called AIG.
And then you also AGF. Packaged and sold those loans is mortgage-backed securities. You also traded in them. And
what I was going to point out is that fortunately AGF did not participate in, as my understanding, any of the exotic mortgage products during that period of time, and didn't participate in lending in what were deemed to be the hot markets that we now discover. So whilst their results have not been at the level that we would normally expect them to be, they have not been as bad as others in their industry.
Because the first panel indicated that you were invested heavily in subprime mortgages. So that's direct. That's not mortgage-backed securities. That's in the mortgages themselves.
I don't quite understand the question.
The first panel indicated that part of AIG's problems were that your financial services institutions invested heavily in subprime mortgages. In what form was that investment held?
I think that's the clarity that's required. These are super senior credit default swaps. These are the transactions that AIGFP participated in. So there are, and we've made very, very fulsome disclosure on this. In fact, we've been complimented by the investment community and others about the fulsome disclosure that we've made, and it's all on our website and has been for many quarters, is that they were effectively insuring, and I'm no expert on this, but effectively insuring the super senior level of the transaction. So there are tranches of bonds, the CDOs below that, whether they're equity, triple B, double A minus, double A, triple A, and then there's another layer of protection before you get to the super senior. And what you're doing, and again, I'm no accountant, but you're valuing the assets that are underlying the super senior transaction. So that's, what FP wrote was a super senior credit default swap portfolio.
Okay. My concern that I have mentioned in many of these hearings is that I'm from Ohio. We're one of the leaders in foreclosures. You can go drive through neighborhoods in my community. You can see the abandoned houses that are there. Our experience has been that predominantly these are a result of refinances where the loan ultimately, where the consumer gets in trouble, the value of the loan exceeds the value of the house at origination. That there are terms, many times capitalization of the fees, there are terms that ultimately cause the homeowners to get into trouble. Sometimes it's financial circumstances of the consumer that causes that they can't keep up with the payments, but usually it's something to do with the mortgage product itself that causes the initial stress. And a realization by the consumer that the mortgage value is higher than the house value itself. So they don't even have the ability to sell the home, which you would find in normal then real estate transactions, to escape their liability. They are in effect trapped and have the only recourse, not having the financial resources themselves to make up the gap, of abandoning the property, causing therefore the foreclosure if they're not able to keep up. In the county in which I reside, it's about 5,000 foreclosures a year now in a community of about 500,000 people. State of Ohio is experiencing somewhere around 80,000 a year. Every 3 years, that's a geographic size of one full congressional district. It's been interesting listening to you, Mr. Sullivan, about your discussion of mark-to-market, because I was actually, until you began talking about it, kind of leaning toward perhaps maybe it was a policy that was a problem. But after hearing your statement on giving bonuses not based on upon excluding losses, and your statement of these aren't really realized losses, that mark-to-markets, as you said, unintended consequences followed, I'm beginning to think that the advocates for significantly reducing mark-to-market applications are trying to say that we shouldn't look at value without looking at current value, which is kind of like your bonus description. So my concern here, though, is that if mark-to-market is a process that people get concerned with when markets fluctuate, if we have a situation where the loans are originated at a higher than the value, the mark-to-market on day one would tell you that the underlying mortgage security is not properly collateralized. In your discussions on the subprime effect, mortgage-backed securities, with the swaps, did you ever have any discussions in your company where you heard that in fact some of these mortgages perhaps exceeded the value at loan origination? I'd like you both to answer.
Not to my knowledge.
Not to my knowledge, sir.
Gentlemen's time has expired. Now we go to Mr. Yarmuth.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. I think it was Mr. Bilbray earlier asked the question why AIG was bailed out and not Lehman. I'm going to ask a little bit more direct question, Mr. Willemstad. Did Goldman Sachs have anything to lose if AIG went under?
Goldman Sachs was a significant counterparty for AIG.
And to what extent are the relationships intertwined, and how much do you think Goldman Sachs would have suffered financially? What kind of stake was there for Goldman Sachs in AIG's survival?
I can't tell you what losses Goldman Sachs might have suffered, because I don't know. The only thing I can tell you is that Goldman Sachs was a counterparty on approximately $20 billion worth of credit default swaps that AIG FP had.
So it's a significant interest in AIG's survival,
well,
it sounds like.
Again, I don't want to jump to that conclusion. I don't know how those securities were carried on Goldman Sachs' books, and I don't know whether they were hedged by Goldman Sachs, so it would be very difficult to draw that conclusion.
Sounds like a question we need to ask, Mr. Chairman. Several comments have been made about the fact that AIG was too big to fail. And we saw, I think you were in the room earlier, when the statement of Alan Greenspan about size and the question of whether we let companies get too big. Clearly, by your own admission, in this case, the implications of AIG's failure on the financial markets would be substantial. Is this something that troubles you, that companies are able to reach the size where they can disrupt an entire economy? And I guess the corollary question, or the follow-up question, is what benefits does our society get by letting a company get so big that it puts the entire nation's financial system at stake or at risk?
I'm sorry. I'm not sure I understand the question.
Well, I mean, you're running a company now, albeit for just a few months. Mr. Sullivan ran a company for several years that apparently was so big that its failure went far, the implications of its failure, potential failure, went far beyond its shareholders and its employees. And that's why our government decided that it needed to step in because of that impact. Do you think that it is good that corporations can get to that size in our economy where their mistakes don't just affect them? And do you think there are benefits, if, you know, if we're going to allow companies to get that big, that their failures and their mistakes can affect all of us, then what does society get in return for allowing that company to get so large?
Well, again, I think the size of AIG and the interconnection between AIG and the rest of the capital markets are really the issue. I'm not sure purely size by itself is the determinant factor. I would say also that there have been plenty of benefits to AIG's size, its ability to serve broad markets, to provide competitive marketplace so customers and policyholders can get a good deal, if you will, that AIG was a strong, well-capitalized insurance operation that provided many benefits to its customers and consumers that did business with it.
And that's the question I was asking, because we see this now, and we've seen it in many situations recently where companies that are so large that their failure is just impacts taxpayers throughout the system. And I think the question we have to ask as a society is, are the benefits of that size, whether it's a competitive pricing or whatever, adequate to justify the risk of a company disrupting, making a mistake and disrupting the entire economy? But that's something, a little bit of a, I guess, a 30,000-foot issue in this particular case. One other, just a quick question again. We've had some testimony about the fact that only $60 billion have been drawn down of the $85 billion. What specifically was the $85 billion needed for?
The $85 billion number was a number that was obviously determined by the Federal Reserve. The $85 billion, I believe, was intended to be a loan to cover liquidity needs inside the company. It's been characterized before as covering losses, which I think is not an accurate representation. The loan was taken down after I left the company, so I can't be specific about it. But what happens in a crisis of confidence like this, and what was happening to AIG, was not a question of losses. AIG has had a lot of money borrowed over the years, and when you go through one of these crises, people who have loaned you money in the past stop lending to you. People who give you money or put money on deposit with you want it back. That in another environment, without this crisis of confidence, AIG could have easily met all those obligations. But when you have a series of counterparties who decided for reasons of concern about the viability of the company stop doing business with you, the company can no longer meet its obligations. It's not very much different that if all the consumers of a particular bank showed up one day and asked for all of their money back, there's no bank in America that could provide that. Those dollars of deposits that were given to that bank are loaned out in the communities to small businesses, consumers, credit cards. The whole system is driven around confidence and viability. And once that breaks down, there is no company, certainly in the U.S. and I think anywhere around the world, that can sustain a run on the institution.
Gentleman's time has expired. Ms. Watson has requested that she be recognized next. Does anybody object to that? If not, gentlelady is recognized.
Thank you so much, Mr. Chairman. I think you just about answered my question, but it's about the $85 billion, Mr. Willisted, that has been given to bailout. And as I understand, last Friday, AIG reported it had already drawn down $61 billion of the $85 billion loan. Does that align itself to what you were just describing, that people want their money now?
Again, I don't know what the use of the $61 billion was for, because I wasn't there. I am not there. But I would say, generally speaking, my assumption would be that that's exactly what it was used for.
Yeah. In fact, AIG has drawn down the funds so quickly that credit rating agencies have now begun downgrading AIG again. And back on September 16th, AIG said that the bailout would prevent further rating downgrades. And we know that you're not at the company anymore, and I'm sure you're surprised by how quickly the $85 billion line of credit has been consumed. So one question that my constituents, and I'm sure that all American taxpayers, are asking, can you explain or try to how AIG could burn through $61 billion in just 3 weeks?
Well, again, I don't know what the source or for the use of that money was, but I'm assuming that counterparties who would normally lend money to AIG are no longer lending money to AIG, and consequently, that's where the money is going.
The new CEO of AIG, Edward Liddy, publicly suggested that AIG might take a piece of the $700 billion bailout package that we just passed, so that that would be in addition to the $85 billion that AIG already received. And my question would be to those who can look forward down the economic road, when is this going to end? Will it end? How much are we going to have to spend of the taxpayers' money to keep AIG afloat? Would you have any idea now that you're not actively with the company?
I'm sorry, but I do not.
Okay, well, I appreciate the going out of, you know, line, and I appreciate the gentleman coming here and being straightforward. A little honesty would help us very much. Thank you so much, Mr. Chairman, for accommodating me.
Thank you very much, Ms. Watson. Mr. Braley.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Mr. Sullivan and Mr. Willemstad, I'd like to ask you about the compensation paid to one particular AIG employee, Joseph Cassano. Mr. Cassano was president of AIG's financial product division, the unit that sold the credit default swaps that helped bring down AIG. During his tenure at AIG, Mr. Cassano repeatedly denied that these swaps posed any risk to AIG or its shareholders. And I'm going to quote to you from a September 28, 2008 article in the New York Times by Gretchen Morgeson, which attributes this comment to Mr. Cassano in August of 2007. Quote, "It is hard for us, without being flippant, to even see a scenario within any kind of realm of reason that would see us losing $1 in any of these transactions. The committee has examined Mr. Cassano's pay, and we were shocked to find that AIG paid him more than it paid its CEOs. Over the last 8 years, he earned a total of $280 million in cash, and most of that money came from a bonus program. For every dollar that Mr. Cassano's unit made, 30 cents came back to him and the other financial products executives. On February 28th of 2008, AIG posted losses of $5.3 billion. The main reason for these losses was the $11 billion lost by Mr. Cassano's division. The very next day, February 29th, Mr. Cassano was terminated from his position as president of the financial products division. But when AIG terminated Mr. Cassano, it took two actions that, quite frankly, are hard for your new partners, the United States taxpayers, to comprehend. First, AIG let him keep up to $34 million in uninvested bonuses. And second, the company amazingly hired Mr. Cassano as a consultant for the sum of $1 million a month. So, Mr. Willemstad, let me start with you. As CEO of AIG, you had authority until September 17, 2008, to cancel Mr. Cassano's consulting agreement for cause, but you never did that, did you?
No.
Mr. Sullivan, as CEO for AIG, during the period from March 11, 2008, when this severance agreement was signed between AIG and Mr. Cassano, through June 15th of 2008, you had authority to cancel Mr. Cassano's consulting agreement for cause, but you never took that action, did you?
That is correct.
Mr. Chairman, I'm going to offer as part of the record the consulting agreement of March 11, 2008, which provides the CEO of AIG to terminate the consulting agreement for cause, and I certainly think that in light of what we've heard here today, there was ample justification based upon the misrepresentations made by Mr. Cassano and based upon the financial peril he created for this long-standing company of great reputation in our entire financial marketplace, that that option should have been exercised and something should have been done for the taxpayers of the United States.
Without objection, the document will meet.
And, Mr. Chairman, I agree that this is not a partisan issue, but there have certainly been some partisan comments made about the investigation by this committee of Fannie Mae and Freddie Mac. And I would just like to read for the record a portion of a Financial Times article dated September 9, 2008, titled Oxley Hits Back at Ideologues. This is an article interviewing the former chair of the House Financial Services Division, Mike Oxley, who, instead of blaming Fannie Mae and Freddie Mac, headed the Financial Services Committee and blames the mess on ideologues within the White House, as well as Alan Greenspan, former chairman of the Federal Reserve. In fact, he talked about the GSE reform bill that passed the House overwhelmingly in 2005 and could have prevented the current crisis. And here's what he says, I quote, "All the hand-wringing and bedwetting going on now without remembering how the House stepped up on this," he says, "what did we get from the White House? We got a one-finger salute," end quote. And finally, he says, "We missed a golden opportunity that would have avoided a lot of the problems we're facing now if we hadn't had such a firm ideological position at the White House and the Treasury and the Fed," Mr. Oxley says. And I would offer that as part of the record as well.
Without objection, that may be part of the record.
That
gentleman yield to me?
Yes, I would.
Why didn't you fire Mr. Cassano? You had the ability under the rules under which your corporation operated to fire him, and he's been kept on at $1 million a month retainer. He was discharged. Why didn't you fire him? Mr. Willemstad?
Well, I was not the CEO at the time. Mr. Sullivan had recommended to the board and the compensation committee that Mr. Cassano's assistance in helping unwind, if you will, or work down the exposure in FP would be valuable to the company, and that as part of his agreement, he would have a non-compete, non-solicitation agreement. It was important to keep the existing employees in FP to help work through the sizable exposure.
You were the chairman of the board.
I was.
And you could have insisted he be fired, but Mr. Sullivan told you not to fire him so he wouldn't go out and compete with you? I would have thought you'd want him to go to some other corporation the way he had put yours so deeply in the hole. Mr. Sullivan, why didn't you fire him?
I recommended that course of action to the board, and Mr. Willemstad articulated the reasons very well. One of the things that I wanted to ensure is that we retained the 20-year knowledge that Mr. Cassano had about the businesses. These are long-term transactions. These are not transactions that go on the books and expire 12 months later. They're very long-term, and you want to make sure that the key players and the key employees within AIG FP, we retain that intellectual knowledge. And I think Mr. Williams,
what would he have to have done for you to feel you should fire him? He put you in a situation where you had to come up with $60 billion immediately, and you couldn't do it. Isn't that enough reason to feel that the guy shouldn't be kept on at $1 million a month salary, just to be available?
While at the time, you know, obviously we made that that decision, Mr. Cassano decided to retire, and I believed, and I made the recommendation, as Mr. Williamstad articulated, that his services be retained. And
when I retire, I want to come to work for you at $1 million a month. What a good deal that is, and what a good signal that is. The man goes out on his own in these derivative deals that bring down AIG, and he gets $1 million a month retainer in case you need his advice. Is that what you're telling us?
Well, and in addition, Mr. Williamstad articulated all the reasons there that he had a non-complete, non-solicitation so that we could retain the key employees in AIGFP, bearing in mind these were multi-year contracts. And other this wasn't the entirety of FP's businesses. There were other sectors that they were in as well.
Yeah, thanks. Ms. Norton, I think you're next on the list.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. I'd like to ask both of you questions about your statements as the company was collapsing, because it didn't suddenly fall, suddenly collapse. Mr. Sullivan, let me ask you first. In December 2007, you said the following: "We believe we have a remarkable business platform with great prospects that represent tremendous value." How many superlatives in that sentence? Then you posted a $5.3 billion in losses for the quarter, and that was December. Moved just a few months to February 2008, and then you said, "Based upon our most current analysis, we believe that any credit impairment losses realized over time by AIGFP would not be material to AIG's consolidated financial condition." Then you went on to post $7.8 billion more in losses for the quarter. A few months later, May 2008, you said, and here I quote you, sir, "The underlying fundamentals of our core business remain solid." The next month, the board voted to replace you. Let me ask you, Mr. Sullivan, what was the source of those glowing statements as you were posting loss after loss, quarter after quarter?
Well, I think because you made a reference to a number of statements there, I need to break down my answer, if I may. First of all, my reference to the core operations is talking about AIG's global franchise, because obviously AIG is in a number of businesses, not just the super senior credit default swap arena. Obviously, we have market-leading positions in many other businesses, such as, sorry, I'm talking current. You know, I keep on saying we, I'm no longer there, but for 37 years I was there. You know, they have market-leading positions.
Of course, there were the credit default swaps.
They were.
that were collapsing your fundamental business. Go ahead, sir.
That is correct, but I'm just trying to clarify some of my remarks, because you've taken, there's different topics being covered there. So one is in referring to the core franchise and the market-leading positions that AIG holds in a number of businesses around the world. The other comment is trying to differentiate between the realized loss potential of that portfolio as against the unrealized loss potential. As I mentioned earlier, at the time I left the company, to the very best of my knowledge, certainly to the best of my knowledge at the end of the first quarter, I don't believe AIG had suffered any realized losses. That's not to say they wouldn't suffer realized losses as the market continued to deteriorate. And in fact, we made very fulsome disclosure. As I mentioned earlier, we had tremendous amount of information on our exposures to the root U.S. residential housing market on our investor website,
but
and
would
in our
not be material. Credit losses realized over time would not be material to AIG's consolidated financial condition.
Right, but based on
that's
what I knew
pretty
at the time,
blanket
from a realized
across the
loss
board
standpoint,
statement. That's pretty across the board, pretty blanket.
Yeah, but I was trying to differentiate there, to the very best of my knowledge, the difference between the realized loss situation or the potential realized loss situation as against the amount of unrealized losses.
So it didn't occur to you then, Mr. Sullivan, that in parsing your words this way, that you might be misleading your shareholders?
Absolutely not.
Do you think any of them were misled?
No, I mean, I would refer you, and I'm sure you've been supplied with this information, the very, very fulsome disclosures of our exposures, not only in the CDS portfolio, but in our mortgage insurance company, which was clearly causing me some concerns in the early part of this situation when the issue was...
You had departed very substantially from your core business. Are you saying to me that you believe your shareholders expected to be bailed out by the federal government at some point?
Certainly not. As I testified earlier, when I left the company, I believe the company was in a position where it would certainly not need intervention from the government. If I may go back to the disclosures that we made, one of the things that I set out to do in March of 2005, given the challenges that we had with all of our regulators,
mean disclosures of the losses?
No. When I took office, AIG was facing, as I mentioned, crises very different to the financial crisis. But I made it clear day one that we were going to have a very open and transparent relationship, not only with our regulators, but with our investors as well. And we put very fulsome, I would encourage you to look at that information, we put very fulsome disclosure on our website.
You believe these were fair and honest characterizations and that your shareholders were not misled by any of the three statements, even after they saw the losses posted?
Absolutely. I believe what I said at the time to be truthful, very truthful, based on all the information I was receiving and clarifying, the difference between realized and unrealized losses.
Mr. Chairman, I'm going to yield back the balance of my time, but my question went to misleading. And I must say, in concluding, that it's difficult for me to believe that shareholders were not misled, at least, by the way in which you parsed your words and phrased the condition of the company. Thank you, Mr. Chairman.
Gentlelady yields back the balance of her time, and I now recognize Mr. Van Hollen.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Gentlemen, I want to follow up on some of the questions regarding executive compensation, including the bonus structure. And Mr. Sullivan, let me start with you and ask about your actions at the meeting of the AIG Compensation Committee that took place on March 11, 2008. According to documents that this committee has received, AIG has two bonus programs to reward executive performance. The first is called the Partners Plan. It covers the top approximately 700 AIG executives, and the second is called the Seniors Partners Plan, which applies to roughly the top 70 executives. Now, as CEO, you're paid under both those executive compensations plan. Is that right?
That is part of my compensation.
Now, as I understood it and looked at the rules that AIG had set, they tried to align pay with good performance. Rewards were supposed to be based on the company's performance. If performance went down and the company lost money, bonuses would be reduced or cut entirely. That was what was supposed to happen in 2007. And as a result of the disastrous fourth quarter results in 2007, bonuses under both those plans would have been cut under the normal rules. But according to the minutes of the meeting that took place on March 11th, the meeting of the Compensation Committee, you personally urged the board to rewrite the rules. And according to the minutes, and I don't know if we're posting them on the board, we had them earlier, but let me just read from the minutes of that meeting. It said, Mr. Sullivan next presented management's recommendation with respect to the earnout for the senior partners for the 2005-07 performance period, suggesting that the AIG FP unrealized market valuation loss should be excluded from the calculation. I think it's important to point out that just weeks earlier on February 28th, AIG just posted a record fourth quarter loss, as we've heard about, of $5.3 billion as a result of the AIG FP division. My question is very simple. You've referred to the unintended consequences. The question is, why did you change the rules, the compensation rules that were supposed to be pay for good performance? Why did you change them to give yourself and other executives a bigger bonus?
Okay. If I may, just for clarity, this was not the bonus structure for AIG. These were long-term compensation programs for AIG executives. So just to clarify that for you, sir. And secondly, I was not asking the Compensation Committee to rewrite the rules. I was asking them to use their discretion, which I believe existed under both programs. Coming back to, I testified earlier, I responded earlier, that my concern was that these 700 people that participated in the Partners Plan and the 70 in the Senior Partners Plan, none of them were in AIG FP. They had their, as others have mentioned, their own compensation plan. And my concern was that, you know, other parts of the business that were not being impacted by the events in the credit markets, you know, we would lose key individuals if we didn't at least acknowledge in their remuneration, which was a long-term remuneration. They didn't get their money until sometime later.
Well, if I could ask, I mean, you I understand, despite the fact that you left approximately June of this year, you received the $5.4 million bonus, isn't that right? Is that not correct?
The reference to a bonus, if that was a number under the senior partner plan, I don't have the numbers in front of me. Right. That may be the number, but I mean, it's not referred to as a bonus.
But you received this payment under the senior partners plan, did you not?
It's paid out over a number of years.
I mean, the question is pretty clear. Your company had just taken a record loss. Pay for performance is supposed to be based on how the company performed, and yet you went before the board of directors and specifically asked them to ignore those losses for the purpose of the compensation plan, which had the direct result of giving you about $5.4 million extra compensation. If I could just ask you, Mr. Willemstad, because the minutes say that you were present at this particular compensation meeting, I have to ask you, in your role as a fiduciary to the stockholders, how does that payment, including the payment to Mr. Sullivan and the other executives, ignoring the losses that had just taken place, how does that conform to the rules of pay for good performance, and how does that benefit any stockholder?
If I could clarify some of the things you said, there are actually three components to the incentive compensation plan for Mr. Sullivan. It was the partners plan, it was the senior partners plan, and there was a discretionary bonus. Mr. Sullivan received a $9 million discretionary bonus in 2006 when the company had an exceptional year. Mr. Sullivan's bonus was reduced in 2007 from $9 million to $2.5 million. So to put...
I understand that, Mr. Williams, but I'm referring to a particular request that was made at the board meeting with respect to the senior partners program, and the request was made and complied with by the board, accepted by the board at a time of record loss. And my question is very simple. How did that decision help the shareholders at this particular point in time, which is the responsibility of the board, is it not?
The senior partners plan was a plan that recognized the performance over a three-year time period. 2007 was one of those 3 years. Mr. Sullivan's recommendation was to postpone the recognition of those losses because they were deemed to be unrealized losses. The understanding that the committee had and the board had is that, as Mr. Sullivan mentioned, there were 70 employees who were part of the senior partners plan, none of which had anything to do with the FP operations. It was only Mr. Sullivan who had any direct responsibility for that. So his intention, and I think the board's response, was not to penalize the other 68 or 69 employees for the result of one business unit.
Well, Mr. Chairman, just to conclude, I mean, it seems that pay for performance means you get paid whether it's bad performance or good performance, and you change the rules when it doesn't work out the way intended. I mean, if that's what part of the unintended consequences of this have been, I got to say a lot of people are scratching their heads when they look at how in good times you stick with the general scheme for pay for performance, and at bad times it gets reinterpreted in a way that benefits the executives. Anyway,
gentlemen, yield to me.
I'd be happy to yield.
Just so we can get this straight, Mr. Sullivan, you were the CEO of the whole company, which included the FP in London, right?
That is correct.
Okay. And when it came to the question of the bonuses for the 70 employees, which included you, you asked the board, upon which Mr. Willems sat as the chair, to disregard the losses so that 3-year bonus wouldn't be reduced. Is that right?
What I recommended to the Compensation Committee was that for the purposes of the Senior Partners Plan and the Partners Plan, that they use their discretion in the calculation of the 07 year, particularly.
Not to count the losses, just to count the earnings, but not the losses.
The unrealized losses.
The unrealized losses. Yeah. Now, isn't it also the case that the AIG FP changed the rules as well so that the bonuses there did not calculate the losses, unrealized as they might have been?
I don't think that's correct. No,
I have a document that says so. This is the minutes of the meeting of the Compensation Management Resources Committee of the Board of Directors. And it says, explained that AIG, Mr. Dooley presented management's recommendation, and explained that AIG management believes it is critical to provide a special incentive to assure retention of the AIG FP team while recognizing the serious effects of the valuation losses, and described the proposed terms of the alternative arrangements. Then it goes on to say no individual received compensation exceeding $1.25 million, and employees affected by the reduced compensation will be eligible for the deferred compensation. And it's just, that's the way we read this document. I'll put it in the record and we'll be able to look at it. But you got this FP, you got the bonus, you got the 3-year partner's compensation. Did you get an ordinary salary as well?
Yes, sir.
And how much was that?
$1 million a year.
So you got $1 million a year, and then you got a bonus that was reduced from $9 million to $2.5 million. Is that right?
That is correct.
Okay, and then what else did you get?
My participation in the senior partners and the partners plan.
And how much money was that for that period of time?
I can't recall.
Take a guess. More than $1 million?
I think my colleague here mentioned $5 million. I think, I don't have the schedule in front of me, but.
Okay. We'd like to get it for the record. Let me tell you one person that didn't get a bonus while everybody else was getting bonuses. That was St. Denis, Mr. St. Denis, who tried to alert the two of you to the fact that you were running into big problems. He was blocked by the people in London from even understanding what was going on so he could report to you. He quit in frustration, and he didn't get a bonus. So the one guy that was really trying to do his job, and there may have been others as well, lost out on his bonus completely and was frustrated and felt he couldn't do his job, so he left. I thank the gentleman for yielding.
May I suggest, Chairman, with respect, that the company clarify the contents of the Compensation Committee's report so that you have an understanding. My view, obviously, and I think Mr. Williams that may concur, was that was actually penalizing the FP folks at the time and trying to put a compensation structure in place that they would get rewarded as and when the marks came back. But I'm not
That's not our
that.
Understanding from the document.
Okay. That's why I suggest, sir, for the subject of clarity, maybe it would be helpful if the company explained it to the staff.
Well, you really, whatever penalties you imposed upon them, it's hard to see how difficult it is when you have Mr. Cassano not doing any work, but getting $1 million a month in case you need him, in addition to whatever else he got by way of bonuses and salaries and other money-sharing agreements. This is really quite a good deal.
Mr. Chairman, I would just say, I mean, obviously, as CEO, you oversaw the whole FP division as well, and yet you received a bonus despite the fact that they had these huge losses. And so, again, it's just people got to scratch their heads and wonder what pay-for-performance means when you have that kind of compensation structure and going before the board. Anyway, my time is up. Thank you, Mr. Chairman.
Thank you. Mr. Sarbanes.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. I'm just fascinated by this guy, Joseph Cassano, because it appears to me that he single-handedly brought AIG to its knees and was the reason that taxpayers have had to step in with an $85 billion loan. So,
Mr. Sarbanes, could you speak a little
louder? Yeah, I was just talking about Joseph Cassano. Is your office in New York?
When I was with AIG, yes, sir.
Was in New York, and your office was in New York?
Yes.
And Cassano's office was in London?
Well, he spent his time between London and the Wilton offices, okay. Wilton, Connecticut.
So how often would you see him?
Certainly at the FP board meetings, and obviously occasionally when he was in town. He was not a direct report to me. He reported to Mr. Dooley, who was referenced earlier.
And how did I mean, you weren't there, I guess, when the FP thing got started, right?
Well, I was certainly with AIG, but in a completely different division.
Okay, you weren't heading the company up.
No. This was.
But what's the lore? What's the company lore on how that happened? Did Mr. Cassano come to the powers that be and say, I got this really neat idea of what we can do over in London? We can get into this new product line, and off he went? What's the story there?
No. I think if I can, from what I know, and you said folklore, but from what I know, is that a number of executives came out of Drexel and were recruited by AIG at that time to form the capital markets division that became known as AIGFP.
Uh-huh.
I don't believe Mr. Cassano was leading that at the time. He was one of the team that came in, and there were some management changes thereafter where ultimately Mr. Cassano became the head of capital markets. But I think there were two other executives prior to Mr. Cassano who ran that division.
Well, you've probably heard me refer to that office in this hearing before as the London Casino, because I think that terminology captures as well as anything what was happening over there. What I can't understand is why you were allowing these huge losses to build up with apparently no consequence for Mr. Cassano. So I'm just curious, in December of 2007, Mr. Cassano was telling the investors, with the data that you have in front of you, you can play this power game. And then within weeks, AIG posts a loss of $5.3 billion. I assume most of that related to the activities of FP, right?
Yes, okay. The unrealized loss, yes.
Yeah, so when that happened, and this term unrealized losses, which you're very careful to keep restating.
No, it's a loss.
Yeah. Yeah, they turned out to be realized in a big way, it seems. Certainly the taxpayers are realizing these.
Just to clarify, at the time I left, as I said earlier, that none of it realized. What has happened since, I don't know, but it's, you know, just for the
I understand. So $5.3 billion. So then obviously you immediately get on the phone to Mr. Cassano and you say, what's going on over there at FP? Right?
Well, in December.
I'm just assuming. Somebody calls him up or catches him the next time he's in town for a meeting and says, $5.3 billion of unrealized losses for the last quarter. What's happening over there, Mr. Cassano, and what does he say?
That
gives you comfort. Does he tell you the same thing he was telling the investors? Well, we've got all this data, and we can play this power game. So then you say, okay, fine, we'll keep you in there. And then the next quarter, he posts losses of $7.8 billion. And apparently that's still not enough for him to be put on the hot seat. So off he goes to the quarter after that and posts $5.5 billion of losses. I just don't understand, in terms of the company and your stewardship of the company, how you can let this guy run up these huge losses. Apparently, with no consequence to himself in terms of the compensation. So just internally, what was going on during that period? What was the discussion with Mr. Cassano?
Well, clearly at the time of December 2007, there was a lot of discussion taking place within the organization on the whole issue of the CDS super senior portfolio. There's no question about that. It wasn't, don't forget, and I just want to point out that this business had been stopped writing in 2005. So effectively, this portfolio was in runoff. These contracts will mature over a period of time, and as I said earlier, as they mature, if there's no loss on those contracts, that unrealized loss will then come back into the income statement of AIG. So, I mean, that's the point I wanted to make here. This business was stopped in 2005, and I think that's an important thing. And clearly, in December of 2007, a lot of dialogue's taking place between FP. There's additional resources going in there to make sure that we're obviously have the compensating controls in there that I referenced to one of your colleagues earlier. So in December 2005, there's a lot of interaction taking place between FP and the corporation.
So what you're saying is by that time it was, by December 2007 when the losses first started appearing, it was too late. You were already on the downward slide, and yet Mr. Cassano, having set off that situation, is still getting paid $1 million.
What I'm saying is that the portfolio was stopped writing in 2005, and obviously as the credit market's starting to freeze and the subprime issues are coming through, then the losses started to emerge.
Gentleman's time has expired. Ms. Speer.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. To both of you gentlemen, I want to applaud you for the stiff upper lip that you have shown today and under intense questioning. But I've got to tell you that you make a shameful profile of corporate America. To you, Mr. Williamstead, I will say thank you for foregoing your golden parachute. And to you, Mr. Sullivan, shame on you. The shareholders of that company have nothing, and you walked away with $15 million. Now, I'd like to ask a question of you, Mr. Williamstead. In the final days, evidently Goldman Sachs CEO was in on meetings. Is that correct?
That's my understanding.
You were not in those meetings?
I was only at one meeting when the CEO of Goldman Sachs was there.
And he was there. And what was he saying?
This was a meeting that took place on September 15th at the Federal Reserve. The Federal Reserve had gotten Goldman Sachs and J.P. Morgan together to try and find a private solution to AIG's liquidity issues. That meeting was to discuss how much capital the company might need. That meeting lasted for about an hour and a half, and then the meeting was adjourned.
So they weren't interested in a private solution?
I'm sorry?
The CEO of Goldman Sachs was not interested in purchasing AIG.
No, he was there to participate in looking for a private solution.
Now, you said that Goldman Sachs was one of the counterparties.
Yes.
Of AIG, and that they are owed about $20 billion, is that?
No. As a counterparty, if the securities defaulted, AIG would have to pay that counterparty, Goldman Sachs, the amount of the insurance premium.
So they would receive about $20 billion, though. I used that term earlier. You actually referenced that amount of money.
I did, yes. No, that's the correct number.
Now, AIG has since taken up the taxpayers on $61 billion. Is $20 billion of that $61 billion gone back to Goldman Sachs?
I don't know.
So, Mr. Chairman, I think that's a question we may want to ask subsequently. Mr. Williamstead, do you believe that naked short selling was part of the problem?
Well, AIG stock was down to about $26 in June. Up until September 12th, AIG stock was at $23. So during the course of from late June to early September, there was not much movement on AIG stock. In the last week, from September 8th to September 15th, AIG stock went from $23 to $4. I actually don't know that it was necessarily driven by short sellers, although I would assume there's been some short selling in there.
The rating was a double A on Friday, and 2 days later, you needed a total bailout. How did you go from being double A on Friday to needing a total bailout 2 days later?
Well, the double A minus rating that was provided by S&P and Moody's was the ratings. I had met with the rating agencies actually the prior week and reviewed what our plan was. They were considering a downgrade at that time, and on Friday after 4 o'clock, S&P put out a negative watch that indicated they might reduce the ratings anywhere from 1 to 3 notches. And then I believe it was the following Monday or Tuesday, I'm not sure exactly which, both rating agencies downgraded the company. I'm not sure I've answered your question, but I'm not sure what your question is.
Well, I was trying to understand how you could be rated as double A on Friday, and the following week you need an $85 billion bailout. I don't know how you can go from being a double A. That kind of grading doesn't make sense to me.
You'd have to talk to the rating agencies about that.
All right. One last question, Mr. Chairman. And this gets back to Joseph Cassano. In August of 2007, he says, "It's hard for us with and without being flippant to even see a scenario within any kind of realm of reason that would see us losing $1 in any of these transactions." It's a lot of bravado. In December of 2007, he said, "We have from time to time gotten collateral calls from people, and then we say to them, well, we don't agree with your numbers, and they go, oh, and they go away, and you say, well, what was that? It's like a drive-by in a way." Also in December, and this is a real difficult one to believe, he says, "There are some morbid questions we get about what happens if the world rolls off its axis and the world goes to hell in a handbasket. But with the data that you now have in front of you, you can play this power game." Mr. Sullivan, you were on that same call. You knew that the company was in trouble. You allowed Mr. Cassano to make these statements, and you didn't stop him. You didn't suggest that he was overstating the case. Well, is that transparent? Is that what you should be doing on behalf of the shareholders of the company?
The December 5th meeting, which you refer to there, I think, latterly, we made a very fulsome presentation to the investor community on AIG's full exposure to the U.S. residential housing market. It made reference not only to AIGFP, but our mortgage insurance company, our consumer finance company, and our investments. And I don't want to take any of Joe's comments out of context, but we put a lot of information into, you know, made available a lot of information to the investor community at that time. And I don't want to take the comments he's making out of context without seeing the slides that he was referring to at that moment in time. You know, obviously what we told the market, what I truly believe was accurate at the time based on all the information I had available.
Are you back?
Thank you, Ms. Spear. Mr. Shays, I want to recognize you to close out the questioning, but before I do, I ask unanimous consent that we can put in the record a letter that was sent today to Secretary Paulson. And this is a letter telling Mr. Paulson that we're concerned about the profligate spending at AIG, including the $1 million a month that's being paid to Mr. Cassano. Mr. Cassano received up to $34 million, and even today he's getting paid as a consultant for $1 million a month. And we think this is unfair to the taxpayers of this country. AIG received $85 billion in taxpayers' money, and it's lavishing these kinds of perks on Mr. Cassano and the event that was taking place shortly after the government took over. Without objection,
Chairman,
the letter will be made.
Could I ask who signed the letter?
The letter has been signed by Mr. Braley, Mr. Cummings, Ms. Spear, and myself.
I'd like to be associated with that letter.
Okay.
Thank you.
Mr. Shays, you're now recognized.
Could we make it bipartisan and add my name to it?
Well, certainly will.
Thank you.
Mr. Bilbray, you want to join us?
Yes, Mr. Chairman.
Okay.
Mr. Willstad and Mr. Solomon, thank you for being here. There's one thing I think there's unanimity on in the part of members on both sides of the aisle, that we are deeply troubled by the compensation that has been paid to executives who, frankly, were not experiencing success, and we don't think it was truly the executives' money to take. Ripples from defaults on subprime loans underwritten by the toxic twins, Fannie and Freddie, grew to a tsunami that helped swamp Lehman Brothers and others, including AIG. And Fannie and Freddie were able to launch more than $1 trillion of bad paper into the private market because regulators and Congress let them do it. Now, what I want to do is ask you, Mr. Chairman, I have a question for you as it relates to the testimony of Mr. Greenberg. Mr. Greenberg, my reading of his comments and testimony, Mr. Chairman,
yes.
My reading of the testimony from Mr. Greenberg that was submitted to the committee is basically accusing the two individuals who are in front of us for all the problems of AIG. And I'm thinking how convenient we don't get to question him. And my question is, do we swear in the individual to make sure that their statement is under oath and that they are held accountable for what they say?
Well, the gentleman yield. We invited Mr. Greenberg to testify. He responded that he was not well enough to come. He did submit information testimony to us, which will be part of the record. While he wasn't here to take the oath and no oath was administered to him, there are laws that say if a congressional committee is doing an investigation and someone knowingly misleads or gives misinformation, that would be tantamount to a crime in and of itself.
Okay. Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Let me ask you to respond to his comments. He said, moreover, and this is testimony to the committee. Have you read his testimony?
No, no sir.
Moreover, unlike what had been truly been true during my tenure, the majority of the credit default swaps that AIG wrote in the 9 months after I retired were reportedly exposed to subprime mortgages. By contrast, only a handful of the credit default swaps written over the entire prior 7 years had any subprime exposure. So later on, he says, how did this happen? I was not there, so I cannot answer the question with precision. But reports indicate that the risk controls my team and I put in place were weakened or eliminated after my retirement. I'd like to ask each of you, is this true? Were they weakened?
Well, I think that there's two parts there. I don't know what constituted the subprime exposure on the contracts written when Mr. Greenberg was CEO and thereafter, so I can't comment on that. All I can tell you from a risk control standpoint.
Well, I don't understand that question. I mean, you run the company. You're not aware of the exposures you had earlier on?
Oh, no. What I said is I haven't got an analysis to hand as to what the percentages were in response to Mr. Greenberg's statement. Sorry, though. What I can tell you from a risk control standpoint, it was exactly the same risk control procedures that were in place when Mr. Greenberg was in office that continued thereafter, both at the subsidiary level and at the parent company, that ultimately resulted, obviously, in the decision taken to stop writing that portfolio. As I said, at that time, I was focused on other issues
so
that were confronted.
He preceded you, correct?
Preceded me, yes, sir.
Yes. But he's basically blaming you, primarily, and he's blaming Mr. Willstead as well for the short time, but you were on the board and so on. So he's blaming both of you. Your testimony is that you did not change any of the controls that existed beforehand.
In fact, you know, what I would say from when I took office, as I mentioned earlier in response to one other question, I set out with support of AIG's board to actually put in additional resource and enhance systems, not only in our risk area, but in our legal, compliance, finance, and accounting areas.
Your point is you take issue with his statement.
Yes, sir.
Okay. Mr. Donnallo, who testified, and I thought it was very interesting, there are about four paragraphs, but he says that brings us to the issue of what happened to AIG. The history has been well reported in the press. Using its non-insurance operations, AIG, just like many financial service institutions, invested heavily in subprime mortgages. AIG's financial products unit, a non-insurance company, sold hundreds of billions of dollars of credit default swaps and other financial products. As with other financial service companies, AIG was forced to mark to market and so on. But your credit default swaps were basically, how did they relate to the subprime mortgage? You didn't buy subprime mortgages, but you basically, my understanding is, you insured them in a sense, correct?
Correct. What I tried to explain to the previous question that I had is that what we were underwriting was the super senior
portion of the CDS.
I know you're trying you're trying to tell me you got the best. You were trying to secure the best ones.
Well, we actually wrote the super senior transaction.
I understand, they all were terrible.
Well, no, the bonds, the way the structures flow, and it's not easy to explain in a few minutes, is that you're writing a swap on lots of bonds that sit below you, and they can be, it can be an equity tranche, it could be a triple B tranche, and the way these were structured was that AIG swap sat over and above the AAA and a little bit more additional protection. That is why, with respect, I've been trying to differentiate between the unintended consequences and the realized losses when you've had to mark to market in a liquid market.
We're going to deal with this in the Financial Service Committee, and it's probably going to scare the hell out of you, because this committee, I'm sure, is going to look at how we dice and slice all these mortgages, so it's very hard for people to have any sense of what their values truly are. And I don't know what that will do to the marketplace, but clearly we are going to be looking at that. And what I want to establish on the record, though, is that you were involved in the subprime market and you did have credit swaps relating to the subprime market. And you can give me the refinement of that, and I don't want to listen to a long dialogue, but isn't that true?
To the best of my ability,
you can say no or yes if you want.
Well, some of the bonds below the tranche that we were writing could have been in the subprime area.
Right. Thank you. Let me just ask you, as it relates to the Compensation Committee, I'm absolutely convinced that it's one person scratching someone else's back. You're on the board of one company, you serve as a CEO of another. Do either of you serve on the boards of any other committee, of any other companies?
Public companies, no, sir.
No public, yourself?
No public companies.
You are the exception, not the rule. But the question I want to ask you is, did your, describe to me the compensation committee.
The compensation, I made the structure of it, sir?
Yes.
As I mentioned earlier, there was a base salary.
No, I don't. I want to know who appoints the compensation committee.
Oh.
Are they employees of the company?
No, sir. No. The compensation committee consists of independent directors of the board.
They're members on the board, correct?
Independent members, yes.
Right. Not employees of the company.
That is correct.
But how are they appointed?
From what I recall, and you could defer to my chairman at the time, the recommendation of the committee membership is made by the Nominating and Governance Committee to the board at large, I believe, is the process.
That's correct.
Well, my sense is that it's a club, and the club basically rewards their friends.
Gentlemen, yield to
yes.
me? We've held a couple of hearings in this committee about these compensation committees that are appointed or consultants that are selected by the boards. And oftentimes, the people that are selected are doing other consulting work for the corporation that's much more profitable for them. And of course, they receive that from the management of the corporation. So they're then deciding what the compensation will be for the management of the corporation with clear understanding that they may well have a conflict of interest. I think it's an issue that we need to continue to explore on this committee, and I thank you for raising it.
Thank you. Would you allow me one more minute to close?
Yes, sir.
Yeah. We all have our constituents. I have a friend who just wrote me, sent me an email, and he said, "My wife and I are among those investors who got badly burned with Lehman bonds. I am sure many in your district have a similar experience. We are prudent investors who must rely on the store of capital we have accumulated over the years to live decently. We always save more than we earned. Unlike the country and most citizens, we are completely debt-free. We invested very significant amounts in what the so-called rating agencies called AAA Lehman Brothers bonds. It now turns out that our trust in the rating agency was sadly misplaced. Either through incompetence or criminal fraud, they led honest investors astray. Bonds that we bought are at par are now worth 10 or 12 cents on the dollar. This is why we're having these hearings, because you may see your shareholders hurt, but there were far more than your shareholders that are hurt. And it is, I won't read the rest of it, but you should hear what he says about what it means to him to see CEOs of companies getting huge sums when they are working on 10 cents on a dollar on money they saved for most of their life.
Thank you, Mr. Shays. I want to thank the two of you for being here. You came here voluntarily. You've been here for many, many hours, been very generous, and I know it hasn't been easy for you, but we very much appreciate it. That concludes our business, and we stand adjourned.
So a hearing by the House Oversight and Government Reform Committee wrapping up. Bit of a short protest there in the back of the hearing room in the Rayburn House office building. Testimony today by two former CEOs of AIG. The committee chairman, Henry Waxman, said today that AIG executives spent $440,000 on a retreat at a posh resort a week after the federal government's $85 billion bailout of the insurer. This according to TheHill.com. AIG also continues to pay $1 million a month to an executive at the center of the company's failure, Waxman said. The lawmaker added, their executives are walking away with millions of dollars while taxpayers are stuck with billions of dollars in costs. Again, that story from The Hill. This was the second of at least five House Oversight and Government Reform Committee hearings on the financial markets. The rest of the series takes place later in the month, with the third hearing looking at the regulation of hedge funds on October 16th, then the breakdown in credit ratings agencies on October 22nd, and the role of federal financial regulators October 23rd. Earlier today, Chairman Waxman also announced that he'd schedule a hearing looking at Fannie Mae and Freddie Mac. All those hearings will begin each of those days at 10 a.m. Eastern. We'll have them for you live here on C-SPAN. And, of course, you can watch all of these, read testimony and articles, see briefings, and related events at our website, cspan.org. In some related economic news today from the Associated Press, Federal Reserve Chairman Ben Bernanke warned that the financial crisis has not only darkened the country's current economic performance, but also could prolong the pain. The Fed chief's more gloomy assessment appeared to open the door wider to an interest rate cut at the central bank's next meeting to brace the wobbly economy. Bernanke said the Fed will need to consider whether its current stance of holding rates steady remains appropriate given the fallout from the worst financial crisis in decades. We'll show you Chairman Bernanke's remarks in about a half hour from now here on C-SPAN. Also from the AP, the top congressional budget analyst says pension plans have lost as much as $2 trillion in the past 15 months. Peter Orszag told a House panel today that the losses are likely to force many workers to hold off on major purchases and delay their retirements. President Bush spoke this afternoon in Chantilly, Virginia about the economy and the